My name's Jon Hiseman. My band was Colosseum and Tempest and Colosseum 2 and Barbara Thompson's Paraphernalia, and I have actually just received the Prog Visionary Award.
Jon, what does it mean to you to be officially hailed as a visionary?
Well, it's a bit scary because, as I said in my little speech, frankly, I mean, it implies I knew what I was doing, and I'm not sure I was or did. I just did what came naturally, what seemed the easiest to do, you know. Well, I don't know, really. I mean, I'm not sure I'm not sure. I mean, we mixed jazz and rock for the first time, really. I think that's probably where I stayed. We didn't change things. We also didn't just play 3 or 4 minute songs. Our songs were never less than 5 or 6 minutes. Most of them were 15, and some of them were 20, 25, and 30. So we, in a way, we made the first, or amongst the first ever concept albums, where you take a whole theme and you make a whole album around that theme, instead of just having a collection of tracks. The other thing is, of course, that when I actually signed with my first manager, Jerry Bron, he said to me, right, now, I should be producing the singles. And I said to him, hang on a minute, Jerry, we don't do singles. We're an album band. And he was shocked, because that didn't exist. You didn't just make albums. So again, you know, these were the kind of changes that we made without realizing we were doing anything special. It was simply the way we wanted to work. Well, I started off as a drummer in a classical orchestra. And I went directly from that to free jazz, where there was no time and no rhythms and no beats. I made an album with a man called Mike Taylor, which some top American players heard and thought was extraordinary. We had not heard anything like that from anywhere else, although that was also going on in America, but we hadn't heard any of it because the records weren't coming here. So this was where I kind of started, which is crazy, and then I moved back into straightforward jazz, and from there I moved into basically blues. And the blues, of course, has shuffles and rock rhythms. The net result is shuffles and rock rhythms mean that suddenly you're able to work a completely different way on the drums, rhythmically with the bass player, and then you've got the same jazz solos going on top. So actually what I did really came from the blues. When I formed Colosseum, Dick Hextall-Smith thought that he was joining a blues band. He wanted to be the world's greatest blues saxophonist. But in fact, of course, what happened was that my vision was that we played blues sometimes, but that we pushed the music way on beyond blues. And he went with it, and it worked.
What for you is the true spirit, the essence of progressive music?
Well, the essence of progressive music, it must do stuff that hasn't been done before. I mean, that's really what progressive means. Now, I mean, you've got to be in the right place at the right time. And it's getting harder and harder because, of course, you have to remember that a lot of it's already been done. Whereas when I started, a lot of it hadn't been done. So from that point of view, it's much more difficult for the young artists today to come up with something genuinely new. But, you know, if you've got talent and if you've got a way of doing things that is unlike other people's, you can create something new for sure.
Where for you do you think those new frontiers are, if they even exist anymore?
I don't know, and that's the honest truth. I don't know. I think a good artist is a good artist is a good artist. I still think that rock music is voice-based, and I think great voices, great rock voices, front great rock bands, and I've always thought that. I think that it's going to be much more difficult for youngsters today to find something new to say or to do, but it's got to be possible. It's got to be possible. And as long as it's not machine-based, as long as it's music-based, as long as it's people giving performances, the most wonderful thing that's happened in the last 10 or 15 years is that although the CDs died, the record industry doesn't pay the kind of royalties it used to or anything like that, live performances are back with a bang, with a vengeance. And that has to be the greatest thing that's going on, because at the moment, it's the one thing that they can't duplicate, fix, digitalise. You've got to go and see a band if you want that experience. That's fantastic.